mostly in connection with two Alexander elements, obviously the pattern language and notes of order. But the first thing I actually wanted to say was that Chris has always had very important co-workers, and they very rarely actually get mentioned. It's always Chris Alexander, and he certainly, thank you, and he certainly has been the guru. He has been the man who has taught us, all of us students through the years, and colleagues and associates. But the realization of some of his ideas, really, a lot of the credit goes to those who joined him in a kind of loyalty format to make the work visible, to build the buildings, to get the books finally published, to do the drawings. At any rate, I just wanted to acknowledge there's several of you here who have substantially helped him, and I just want to mention that. I'm going to say that the nature of order and the pattern language are both concerned fundamentally with beauty, but they take quite diametrically opposed approaches to beauty, and I will try to explain that. And I'm going to ask then, toward the end, whether these approaches have the ability to generate beautiful buildings. And then, if I still am here, I will talk about, I think, some of the shortcomings of this work. Kyo did a good job of summarizing my career. I'm an architect, not an academic. I think this is important. This teaching I do is a part-time teaching. I come in, I do one course, but I do not get involved in the administration or the responsibilities of the institution. So it's a delightful experience, but it's not the core of what I do. I've been an architect for 35 years. And that colors, of course, how I see all of the work. I want to also begin by talking about what is beauty. I think it's worth talking, what are we talking about? What are you talking about beauty? Is it just in the eye of the observer? Is it just, no. I think we can be specific. So I have four specific descriptions of what beauty is. I think that a beautiful object is whole. And what I mean by that is it's complete. It's not lacking anything. But it's also economical in the sense that you can't take anything away from it without hurting it. So I mean an animal, a plant, it's whole. It's got everything it needs. But if you start taking away one of its important characteristics, it stops existing as a beautiful object. Whole. Number two, beauty embodies a kind of truth. It exposes everything about itself. It hides nothing. And it embodies eternally valid relationships, such as a human relationship or a geometric relationship. I get two more. Functional adequacy of excellence. It works beautifully. That leads to beauty. that applies to many different objects, of course. It's not just organic world. It applies to mechanical things that we make. If they're exquisitely functional, we recognize beauty there. And finally, I don't think we discuss this that often. We demand that beauty not be evil, that it be on the side of the good. And I noticed that in the talks, there's going to be one of the presentations that talks about the moral aspect of patterns, which I'm going to look forward to hearing, because I believe that's an important element. Okay, so that's, you can question what I'm saying. I'm letting you know how I look at it. Beauty, of course, generates pleasure. And I've got a whole bunch of kinds of pleasure here. Physical pleasure, the smoothness of touch, the comfort of a well-shaped chair, a sunny corner of the house where you settle in, sun's coming in, you're reading a book, drinking some tea. That's physical pleasure. We feel it in our body. Then there's the psychological experience that beauty, I think, comforts psychological pain, fatigue, ennui, and angst. It's hard to see something really beautiful and to have it not elevate your psychological frame of mind. It strengthens our inner landscape. Then there's the emotional aspect. It can flood through us. If we are touched by a beautiful story, a musical passage, or a beautiful building, that's what a business I'm in. And we may be surprised by the force of that emotion and not really understand where the force of that comes from. It overwhelms us a bit. And finally, I include intellectual pleasure. We grasp the beautiful object's source and its truth. This can range from awe and wonder to a calmer understanding of its beauty. There are beautiful ideas, beautiful vistas, beautiful geometries. All of these are intellectual pleasures. I want to mention that beauty then gives us so many different kinds of pleasure, and this is going to be important to what I later say. It includes comfort, satisfaction, but also stimulus, excitement, and challenges that can even be a little fearful. We are drawn to some of these challenges. So, beauty and the pattern language. I'll first talk about that. We were, in the 60s and 70s, confronted not with the highest achievements of architects, but we were surrounded by the work of maybe good architects, so-so architects, not-so-good architects. And these buildings that were going up typically were modern in flavor, and they would often take down a beautiful building and put up one of these kind of cold, colorless, it's terrible. And this caused us pain. We were in architecture because we wanted to create beautiful buildings, of course, but looking around, we didn't like what was was going on. It's also true, of course, that we didn't like what was going on in society. Times of war, times of the corporate model. It was stiff, very stiff, unnatural, and we were tired of it. However, none of us working together on the pattern language, we really didn't have any experience building real buildings. We hadn't gotten a client, had the responsibility of designing, doing the construction drawings, making sure the building got built properly. No. We didn't have experience. We were kids with great passion, but kids. The only exception actually was Sarah Ishikawa, I want to mention, because she had worked for 5 years in firms, and she was the only one of us that had any real experience. Anyway, given the fact that we have a passion for beauty and in architecture, what do you do? Well, you go back to basics. You look at a building you like, that you love, that you think is beautiful, and you say, why is that working? And you say, I think I know the important, deep reason that this thing is working on its site. Or I think I see why it's working with the sun. Or I see why the circulation is beautiful. So you examine buildings that you think are marvelous, and you extract patterns that you think explain it. I'm going to turn to the fact that Chris had published a book called Notes on the Synthesis of Form. This, I think, was his PhD thesis. It turned into a book, and it was quite a marvelous book. It was very technical in the sense that it was quite mechanical, and it looked difficult. It set forth a method of dividing up all of the things that don't fit in a problem and gathering them into clusters and then solving that cluster. It was the progenitor, really, of patterns. But Chris had a reputation, certainly when he came to Berkeley. He's the theoretician. He's the methodologist. Berkeley was full of methodologists when I was there. There was a whole thing called the design methods group. These were people who, they did evaluation, they did client participation, they were rationalizing the design process, doing statistical methods, using computer design, computer graphics, everything. And that group asked me to interview Chris, because here he was in the department, and they felt, well, Chris is obviously a design methodologist. So I interviewed him. He said two meaningful things during that interview, and I'll quote him. He says, I'm definitely concerned with trying to make better buildings. The frame of mind that you need to be in to create a good building. Are you thinking about smell and touch? And what happens when people are walking about in a place, but particularly, are you at peace with yourself? Well, this did not belong necessarily in the design methods group. This was something quite different. Further in this interview, for him, good, when he says he wants to design good buildings, it really meant beautiful. He denied that the notes on the synthesis of form was a design method. He says, I quote, I wanted to be able to create beautiful buildings with the same kind of beauty that traditional architecture have. Even the simple emphasis on function and requirements in this book, Notes, was for me merely a way of getting at beauty. Well, this would have surprised many people back when the book came out, that here this extraordinary method, an analytical method, that the guy is actually shooting for beauty. It looked like really he was just trying to make a better teacup or teapot, better, more functional. These two things, you need to be at peace with yourself, and I'm mainly interested in beauty. These two things really emerged full-throated in the Nature of Order book. But not in the pattern language. This book, in the pattern language, we said, well, this is simply, we're going to solve problems. We're going to identify a problem, we'll give you a hypothesized solution. We know it's probably not very finished. Some of them actually are pretty good, some of them aren't so good, but that's all it is. The word beauty does not exist in this book. And in contrast to the fact that he says, oh no, this work is not a design method, it really is pretty straightforward. You choose a list of patterns from the book that are appropriate to your project. You apply them in a certain order. Each one you apply as it makes sense in your project. That is a method. But it's interesting, the book doesn't give you any advice about the proper attitude or emotional preparation required of you. You don't have to be at peace with yourself here, you just do it. Now it turns out that if you do it, all of a sudden peace begins to descend on you. It starts to become pretty easy. Hey, I think I know how to do that. That's nice. I agree with that pattern. I think I know how to apply it to my problem. Hey, this is great because I don't have to worry about the design fads. I don't have to worry about what's in the magazines. I don't have to worry about even what they're teaching in architecture schools. I'm in charge here, and I'm going through the thing, and it's working. So it was empowering to the person who went ahead and used it. And it did give a feeling of peace, calmness. It was fun. It was a nice experience. Was designed for laymen to use. Anybody. Of course, we hope that architecture students would use it. I don't know whether it was a dream. We actually maybe thought that architects would like this thing. They would say, Jesus, you guys are really smart to do this. Well, the book, of course, as everybody knows, is very popular with the laymen. In general, it hasn't been popular at all with the profession. In this book, the word architect never appears. No, we don't need architects. This happens to be a German edition that was over here on the table. And I want to talk about the book itself in relationship to beauty. This does have 1,200 pages, but it's pretty comfortable. You can carry it around. It's a nice size. It's got a pretty nice red cover, and it's got gold embossing on it. Beautiful. The pages are Bible-like. You are holding something valuable and beautiful in the book itself. So we selected photographs, mainly Ingrid King. That was her job. We'd have a pattern, and her job was to find images, photographic images, which could be the lead-off for that pattern and be inspirational. Inspirational, beautiful. So here's a 6-foot balcony. Balcony was big enough to allow a group, a team, put a book down, have a view. And of course, we chose that it was covered. That's not really part of the pattern. The only part of the pattern is a 6-foot balcony. But the thing is, kind of put together, the photograph is chosen so that this is attractive. It looks like it's a beautiful experience. I think that the structure of this book, it goes from the region, the city, the neighborhood, the building, the rooms, the circulation, details. That is a beautiful structure, especially when each pattern is completing patterns above it in the order, and in turn, that pattern needs to be fleshed out and completed by later patterns in the book. Well, this structure is a beautiful idea, and I think that appeals to people also. It's not just the look of the book. So now, going back on my idea of what is beauty, I think that the book is functional. I think people can use it. This was part of my graduate work. I would give them, ask them to select a list of patterns, try to keep it simple, do a simple design, and see if they could use it. And I'll show you some examples later. I think this is functional. When I say functional, I don't mean that the results are necessarily beautiful. I just mean it gets you to start designing, gets you going. Okay? Is the material true? And I would say yes. What I mean is that when we identify a problem, we don't just invent that problem. We think it's a real problem. We think that if light only comes into a room from one side, it will create a glare and it'll be unpleasant and it's not a nice room. That's real. And we say, put windows on two sides of that room and that will improve your experience, be more comforting. In that sense, we thought this was true, real stuff. Was it good? Is this a force for the good? We thought so. We thought that this would move architecture into a healthier, more humane direction. We felt we were good guys. Now, not everybody agreed. The majority of the architectural faculty at Berkeley, there were exceptions, but the majority thought this was dangerous. some people thought it was intellectually weak in assuming that what is good for one is good for all. They objected to that basic idea that this was basic human behavior which applied to everybody. They said, well, it might be good for one of you, but it's not good for everybody. Others felt that it presented a medieval aesthetic rooted in Europe and not applicable to the modern world. Now, of course, we have to admit there we can see why that was. People were led to that because they start looking at the pictures and they said, wait a minute, I don't, all I see is ancient Europe here. That's what I see. On the other hand, the book was taken seriously by a few schools, and I wanted to mention Oregon, Kansas State University, both of these in the United States. Helen reminds me and tells me that it was taken seriously at Darmstadt, right? And as an example, there's a new school starting in Naples, which is it's being presented in this first display here. You should go check it into it. It's going to be based on Alexander principles of design, and they've got their first year of students signed up, and they're going to start this semester. That should be interesting. Now, of course, the question is, does the pattern language produce beautiful buildings? Right. Well, I don't know whether you guys have, how many of you have had the experience. Somebody will come up to me and they'll say, oh, you know, you had something to do with the pattern language. We love the pattern language. We chose two patterns out of this book, and then we had an architect use those two patterns and they built our house around us. And I look at the pictures they show me, I say, well, this is not this is a normal house. This is exactly the same as all other houses. But they feel somehow that by choosing a pattern or two, they've got it made. Now, at the other extreme is the authors of the book as they try to make beautiful buildings. Here's these people, I mean, what can they do? They're talking about beauty, they're talking about patterns. So to give a diversion here before I answer that question and to get to it gradually. For some years before the publication of this, there was a great interest in responsive house building technologies. How do you come up with a house building technology that is humane, that people can use, that produces nice buildings? There was a conference in 1972. Alexander and I presented two papers. He lays out the specifications for a human building system. Let me just read a few of them. Polygonal room plans with no acute internal angles. Makes sense to me. A grid of posts, continuous beams connecting the post, thickened openings at doors and windows, and angled braces between verticals and horizontals. So, he summarized this paper in a very simple, straightforward sketch. There it is. And this obviously suggests a post and beam structure. You just look at it and say, yeah, it's supposed to be. And then in my paper, which Chris suggested I add his name to as co-author, of course I did with great pleasure, we added the notions of thick walls, easy repair, and the use of human-scaled building elements, things that you could pick up and carry over, you could hold up, you could work with. We offered the Japanese house tradition as an example. Pieces that could be handled, straightforward pattern of how you do it, simplified, of course, by the tatami mats. Standard construction, and I was just thinking recently, yeah, standard. You know, no Japanese layman could ever have been able to build such a house, which requires such sophisticated and complex joinery. No. But we held that as a design example. And then part of my work at the center was to come up with a building system. And I love balsa wood and glue and everything, so I came up with a system consisting not of big posts in wood, but maybe 4x4 posts of wood, beams, double beams, which would go around a post in such a way that it would be very easy to drill through and bolt the pieces together. No Japanese fancy joinery. These posts would also form the joints between siding and also the openings around doors and windows. The outside of it was to be sheathed in plywood or some dead wood. And I asked, as part of my work at the center, I asked subjects to come into the center, sit down, take the pattern language, take a few simple construction rules, and see, could you design a house? And this is one of the better ones. They could follow it. I'm not saying it's beautiful. It's a schematic design. It's a beginning. They've got the columns at the corners. They've got many of the patterns. Many of the patterns, some of the houses don't work that well, but it works. It starts to work. Now, doing the pattern line, you'll notice the system is not contained in this book. Because Chris, at a certain point, said, no, no. We need a system based on concrete, albeit lightweight concrete, and we'll form it in wood and we'll reinforce it. Why? Because your structure here is too thin. It's going to be too thin. It's not fat enough. But I think that there was another reason. I think he was simply more comfortable with mass. Based on where he grew up, based on where he's from, based on his culture. Well, we had to build a test structure in the backyard of the center where we were, using this system of lightweight concrete. I was not comfortable with this system. I didn't think this was right. Even though I and Sarah, we helped build this thing. And I also illustrated how you use it for this book. But I didn't like it. Now this is the building that was built in back of the center. Some of you may remember this. I don't know. Howard does. Well, I was a little embarrassed by this building. I felt that it was too cute. It was too charming, too storybook. I also felt this rejection of wood, I'm sympathetic to part of it. Chris did not want to use wood because he knew, we all knew that in some countries there is no wood. course, they've used it all up. But that's one aspect. The other aspect is that trees can be grown. And I, coming from the northwest, the Pacific Northwest, I see trees. They're growing using sun, water, air, soil. Ecologically, I thought this was so attractive. I had fallen in love with my balsawood model. There it is. So, at the same time, this house in the backyard, the center has begun. We went and built a little cabin on an island up in the Pacific Northwest, just using modest sticks for posts, bolting them on both sides with joists, creating a thickness wherever there was a window. This is a later picture. It did not look this good when it was first built. It was initially sheathed in plywood. And it didn't have any of this stonework in front. That's a later addition, making a fire circle. But look at it in terms of it's got plywood on it, and it's super simple. It had the same square footage as Chris's building in the backyard. And I could participate in the building of this. That was very attractive to me. At any rate, the patent language is basically done. And these were the last days of the group that did the pattern language. We all left Chris to do our own thing. This is when Murray and I decided, okay, we want to be architects. We're not going to be academics, we want to be architects. So we said, we told Chris we're going to start a little practice, which he did not like one bit. There was this breach of loyalty, which I think he felt that if we weren't going to stay and continue working, this was disloyal. And he got mad, really mad. And Murray and I are doing business. We get jobs to do houses, and so did Chris. He got jobs to do houses in the Bay Area, but there was a big difference. He not only did the design, but he commissioned for the construction. And the construction was done by his students and by his associates. Whereas we just were typical architects in the United States. We did the drawings, they were complete construction drawings, and we had contractors building our houses. This was a big difference. I thought we could look at Chris's first house and our first house. This is Chris's Sala house. Oh, it's a terrible photograph. Can you see them? It's terrible, right? Yeah. So, this house, he immediately gave up on the concrete structure of the house. This is a post and beam house. He's got a gridwork of posts and beams. He's got wood floors and span between the beams. But what's unusual about it is he couldn't let go of the concrete idea. The sheathing is a 2-inch layer of reinforced concrete. And it was laid up in layers of alternating colors using 2x12 formwork. That was his method, using immediate labor, his labor. Seth Wachtel worked very hard on this building. Now the inside, again, they're building everything inside, doing all the decoration. Now, I want to go next to the first house, which was so different, because we're doing standard step construction. Standard contractor. And the question is, how did we do? Are we making beautiful buildings? We've been talking about it in the book. And my feeling is they both had some nice, good, beautiful features, but they also had some awkward, even ugly aspects to them. Not unusual. But it wasn't fulfilling the promise. Either of these buildings, I don't think, was fulfilling the promise of the book. They were good enough houses. This was the term that I think describes them. Good enough because the neighborhood is happy, the clients are happy, the contractors are happy. But good enough. I think that the pattern language improves the work of architects and laypeople. No matter what your level of skill, I think the book can improve what you're doing. Beautiful enough to be good enough. I thought maybe I'd stop at this point. Before talking about the nature of order and how that is quite different from the pattern language, does anybody have any comments right now or questions that we could, that you're... How long have I been talking? I've got 20 more minutes. No, okay. No questions? I'll just keep... Yes, please.
Well, so I actually went to the South Islands.
Yes.
And so, interesting experience. I go up there. The first thing that happened was a man walking by with a dog came and talked to me about. He said he was inside the house. And then the mother of the owner drove up in a minivan and was talking about the house and was talking about how the house was not built for children. But they said they worked around it. And so, when I was talking about the history, and I said that, well, that didn't was how is there built to change? And so, they said they're working with it.
Yes. You could go watch it under construction, yes. I also talked to the person who built it, Seth Wachtel, because he teaches in the same department that I do in San Francisco. I was able to interview him. Now, he almost got fired. I don't know where and how many of you who worked with Chris almost got fired.
Several times.
So, one way to get fired would be, one of the best ways to get fired or to get the threat would be to ask for a raise. And Seth almost got fired because he said, look, I can't live on this salary you're giving me. The trouble was that Chris would set the budget for the house that he was doing and everything had to be done within that budget. There was no opportunity to expand. Terrible for the workers. Oh, well. I move on. Thank you. 10 minutes left, I will go. I go. Chris felt that the pattern language was inadequate to create beautiful buildings. And I won't go over what I think are the basics of books. But I will say that it's titled An Essay on the Art of Building and Nature of the Universe. And the word essay is defined as a short piece of writing on a particular subject. So I devilishly went and weighed this book. It comes in at a little over 1 pound. And I went and weighed the nature of order for volumes, which exceeded 13 pounds. That's a bigger book, a bigger work, a bigger thing. I will go then over the three main characteristics of it. I think it's been mentioned. For him, the life of an object, I feel, is similar to the Chinese concept of qi, which is the life energy inside the object. It could be a teacup, it could be a building, it could be any object. His 15 properties, I think, are a major contribution. to our understanding of beauty. I think you can apply them to many different objects successfully. And I think that the 15 properties do define a certain kind of beauty. The kind of beauty that it defines is organic beauty. There are many different kinds of beauty, and I think that the Nature of Order book produces and attempts to produce organic beauty. This kind of beauty, where all the relationships are there. They occur in nature. They occur in edges of shorelines. They are, in a sense, the definition of organic. Then the third item, of course, is the mirror of the self, which is that this beauty you will recognize by asking yourself the extent to which that object is similar to your deepest self. Those are the three biggies in that book. And the question, of course, is, Chris got better in his work, we got better in our work, but the question is, does the latest material in the Nature Order, does that produce beautiful buildings? And really, it's the same as asking, does Chris produce beautiful buildings? He's the only one who can use this technique outlined in the Nature of Order. And I, you know, I'm very fond of him. And I want to reemphasize what a great, great teacher he was. He basically builds my entire foundation for what I think architecture is about. But in this Nature of Order, he is quite undiscriminating in his praise of his own work. What I mean by that, he only shows his buildings. And of course, there's other people in the world who are trying to use these principles. He doesn't show any work by any others. And he doesn't criticize any of his work. They're all wonderful. He doesn't develop and say, this was one of the early ones I did. It had certain qualities, but I noticed some defects that I was able to improve. There's no sense of growth or of learning in his description of the work in that book. I've tried to apply the test of the mirror of the self to some of his buildings, and I see some beauty in some of his work, but I don't feel that correspondence between what he is doing and my inner self. My inner self is more, well, as you can gather from the building that I just showed you, our first building, it's more Bernard Maybeck, Rudolf Schindler, Frank Lloyd Wright, more bony, perhaps more delicate. That's me, my inner self. I'm more bony. I'm more slim. And much of the beauty I see in his work is flavored with traditional European motifs that are part of Chris's background, instead of a universally envisioned architecture that we can all feel reflects our inner nature. I think I have to stop, and I think I should stop. At some other occasion, I'd like to talk about the limitations of the Alexandrine approach, and I'll just mention what I think they are without, or just show pictures. That's what I'll do. I think that the work of Alexander ignores the sublime aspect of beauty. This is the part of beauty that's a little challenging and frightening. I use this painting of The Wanderer by Caspar David Friedrich of 1818, where he stands on the brink of an outlook, precarious, and sees the beauty of a world which is bigger than him. That's scary. This happens to be the Dutch embassy in Berlin by Rep Kohlhaas. To enter the building, you have to walk across a glass floor to get into the building. Helen almost did not go in. She was afraid. The other kinds of beauty that we are not, this is Lou Kahn's John Salk Center, which I think taps in to the sublime. It's not comforting, but there's something beautiful. The whole aspect of intellectual delight, intellectual beauty, is not covered, of course, in pattern language. It's discouraged, certainly by Chris, who does not want any ideas, theories. Get rid of those. But the geometric idea is what makes this building beautiful. And in Palladio's Villas, he's using the interrelationship of numbers, which is clearly intellectual, has nothing to do with feeling. The golden mean, which has been used throughout history, Corbu brought it back. And in Lu Kahn, he took the cycloid, which is the path of the edge of a wheel as it rolls along the plane, to derive the shape of the roofs in his Kimball Art Museum. And of course, Gaudi, this is an idea. What a beautiful idea, huh? Gaudi's use of the catenary curve. And then finally, I want to mention that there are social ideas which are beautiful, can be beautiful. This happens to be Jefferson's plan for the University of Virginia. And he had an idea about the role of professors whose houses are the big elements on these two arms. The students string along in between them and they have covered walkways so they can go immediately to their professor. Everybody ends up in the circular library at the head. And the layout of the gardens is distinguished so that the students get their garden, the professors get their garden. At the end of the cafes and the rooms for guests. It's a beautiful idea. And I think this is the last image, the Schindler House in Los Angeles, where he's designing for two couples. Each member of each couple wants an art studio. Both couples want to share a kitchen. And they want to have a guest come and stay. Richard Neutra came and stayed perhaps too long, but it's an idea embodied in architecture. It's beautiful. Anyway, the reason I'm going over these is to be specific about what kind of beauty Alexander's whole body of work is about. And my thesis is, it's organic beauty. I think I'm done. Except for Walter Gropius's house in Dessau, destroyed. But I guess maybe my final point is that we are problem solvers. We seek out puzzles. We don't want everything answered for us at all time. Now, I always felt there was something nice about this facade. I disagree that it's just, quote, random openings. I don't think Gropius would do random openings. So I started looking for well-formed shapes for interrelations and interpenetrations, for a variety of shape. And of course I noted there's no boundaries because Gropius didn't want to give us the boundaries. He could have done it, but then I think it may have deadened the facade. I think we wouldn't have been as interested in looking at it. I think, thank God, I'm done. Yes. Thank you.